boom hop, ergo propter hoc.
Sound like a scholar.
I know, I sound like a scholar when I say that. See, this is, you can really start to feel like you can BS well. Yeah. When you guys can use fancy Latin, then you sound. I do this at these conferences sometimes, and I'm laughing inside thinking, they probably think it's cool, but I think this is ridiculous. But all right, so this just simply means correlation implies causation. Now, you guys have heard throughout your careers as students that correlation does not imply correlation, right?
Causation.
Oh, sorry. Causation, yeah. Correlation doesn't imply correlation. Yes, correlation does not imply causation, okay? But let's go a little bit further than that, you guys. You guys keep hearing that, and I'll tell you two things. One, I don't think the general public understands that. When they say it and they repeat it over and over, I don't think they fully understand it. And I'm not even, any profession, it's not just the general public. I think this is something we don't fully understand. And there's also lots more subtleties to that. So let's jump into those subtleties. Some of you guys have seen these examples, but I want to use them because they're really effective at driving home the point. So this is real data. This is not fake data. I'm not BSing you here. This is real data. This is looking at the number of people killed by venomous spiders. So that right here is on the right side. So you can see, you know, 5 deaths, 10 deaths. You can see that it moves in the same sort of way. This is a time-directed or a sort of a time sequence of data, and you can see that the spelling bee winning word goes up at the same time. So what's the recommendation here? The recommendation is to advise the spelling bee competition to start having less letters in the word, right? If you looked at this sort of thing, maybe you would use that kind of information, or I can't think of even in the other way.
I'd
but
tell
I mean,
spiders to stop biting people so yeah. that the words would get easier. That's what I would do.
That is true. Carl's got a good idea, too. Tell spiders to stop biting so that we can make it easier on the students doing the spelling bees. Okay. All right. Let's look at another one. So people drowned. This is all from a website. Some of you have seen this. I would say be very wary of marriage. The marriage rate in Kentucky seems to correlate quite highly with those that are dying of drownings in fishing boats. And again, this is real data, but of course you can see that this is put together to be a bit funny, but also to make a pretty strong point. The number of people here who are killed by tangled in their sheets. So cheese consumption, watch out for cheese consumption. I love cheese, and so I'm hoping that I'm not having an effect on people dying of this sort of thing. Let me do one more, and then we're gonna be a little bit more serious. So the number of Nicolas Cage, the films that Nicolas Cage has appeared in, and the number of people drowned by falling in a pool. The crazy thing about these kinds of data sets is that you find that some of them have some really irregular behavior, and then they follow each other. But if we had time, we could run a simulation just in this class. We could break you up into groups of 10 or 20, and we could have you just randomly come up with numbers. And then we could sort of do some fishing experiments where we could see, when is it that a couple different groups just by chance had values that correlated. We won't do that today, but we will sort of dig into a little bit of this particular problem. So anytime you see, especially time series data, well, any data for that matter, when you see this sort of thing, what you want to immediately put in your head should automatically take those two variables, set them down in your brain space and put some sort of a link between them and kind of think there it's clear that there is correlation. You're going to trust that the data is correlated, and you're trying to figure out whether there is some causative direction in those particular arrows. Now, this one, of course, is silly. It's another silliest, spurious correlation that you would find at Tyler Vigen's website that I'll show you in just a second. A lot of you maybe have seen it. You've seen it in my class if you've been in my class before, because I think it's a great way of explaining it. But here's what's going on. Here's how he did it. It's not that complicated. I'm sure it took him a lot of work because he had to go and mine lots, probably thousands and thousands of different data sets, and then picked them out and did all the different combinations, calculated a Pearson correlation coefficient, and just sort of ordered them in terms of those that just by chance had the highest correlation. Now, this was an exercise to demonstrate the silliness of spurious correlation. When you read things in the news and you read in the paper that there's some correlation between variable A and variable B, you should sort of immediately, your spurious correlation warning system should go on. But just the thing here is that this actually happens more than just in the news. This happens in science a lot. And there's plenty of examples where scientists and researchers will go on phishing experiments, and they'll look for variables that have these. They'll keep doing matches until they have that high correlation. And then what do? They then publish it. They report a high correlation coefficient, so the reviewers look at it and go, wow, that is a little impressive. It gets through, it's published, and then it lands in the news. And it's your job to look at it and call BS if it makes no sense.
Let me give you an example, actually, of that one. So, you know, people will say, try to find the genes that are associated with schizophrenia. And they'll go and they'll look at a SNP panel for, say 10,000 different single nucleotide polymorphisms, little genetic markers, if you will, and try to see, well, which ones are associated with schizophrenia. And then they'll find, inevitably they'll find a few that are really, really highly associated with schizophrenia. But the problem is that, you know, you've got one sort of measure of schizophrenia, and then you've got these, and then you're checking 10,000 different markers. And so simply by chance, just like something is going to line up with Nick Cage's IMDb profile, something is going to line up. Some of your SNPs are going to line up just by chance with your measure of schizophrenia. And so when people, if they don't correct for the fact that they've looked at all of these different genes, then they end up reporting artificially high levels of confidence that these genes are associated with whatever disease they're trying to track down.
Yeah, exactly. And just so you know, there are methods to get around that, because sometimes we're humans. We're going to look for kinds of relationships that we think might have a relationship. And there are ways of thinking about your sampling scheme that you can employ so that you can hopefully get around some of these issues. You still may have that spurious correlation, but it'll happen. So you can go to Tyler Vigen's website. It's a great website, and he's got a book on this now as well.